which is not an unreasonable service, but a reasonable service. God, it wash you. God, teach us you. Teach us your ways, Lord. Thinking about you when I woke up in a spirit of prayer about Jeremiah and the pottery house, how the potter was marred in the hand of the pottery. And he made it again. God, I know that, no doubt I've been marred. All of us probably hadn't been our best. And you made it again, Lord. I want you to make us again a vessel can reach lost souls, and a vessel that can be a light to the world. Lord, you said as pottery, clay was in the hand of the pottery, so are we in your hands. That's where I want to be. God, in the name of Jesus, guide us in the way of truth. And we ask you, Lord, for these days, this weekend, and all goes as your will, Lord, through this coming weekend, Lord. And thank you for this eve of the Sabbath. Sanctify us, Lord. Help Sister Terrell and I, Lord, to be sanctified and to stay sanctified, Lord, set apart. Not for ourselves, but for you, and search the hearts of all your ministers, the real, true servants of God, both handmaids and manservants. Lord Jesus, you said the labors of few, add more labors to the fields. You once said the fields are white. Let it be again, but the labors are few. God, help us to be laborers. Help us, Lord Jesus, to buffet our bodies and our spirits. God, and see us. Lord, help us to see us as you see us when we look in a mirror. Help us to see what you see. God, where we can search our hearts, as you said, see if we be in the faith. All in the name of Jesus, Lord, overshadow this city, Lord, for miles about it, God, and Lord, others that might be coming this way. Lord, let the Holy Ghost shine on them, Lord, and let them come hungry and thirsty. God, in the name of Jesus. Oh, Lord. God, I want to be a servant. In the name of Jesus, sanctify us and breathe into us that living soul, holy and clean. Let this mind be in us, Lord, that was in Christ Jesus, that we walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit, that we do as you said, judge not somebody else, lest we be judged with the same judgment, because we don't know what's in one another's hearts. So God, search our hearts, search my heart. And Lord, save souls and cold and indifferent people. God, I keep that man keeps coming before me. Jesus, I was in a meeting back a few days ago, and I can't get him off of mine. Lord, I pray that you'll ever where he's at, Lord. You said your word. God, used to be a preacher, but got off track. Lord, help him. God, let the Holy Ghost search him in all the requests that's coming in. Lord Jesus, whether it's coming through mail or coming through these cards, don't let a solitary need be unmet, God. You told that great apostle, he spoke that his God, which is our God, shall supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory for Christ Jesus. And Lord, search every one of these requests. Don't let a one of them, not a solitary one of them, go unanswered. Lord Jesus, we ask for it to be so, and bless every day, every night of these services, Lord. Let them not just be the same old, let it be what you want it to be. God, all in the name of Jesus. Lord, I'm striving to search the scriptures. God, for in them we think we have eternal life. But there are they that testify of you, Jesus. All in Jesus' name, and bless every request, Lord. And if you've got a request out there, hold your hand up and believe in your heart and agree with Sister Turley and I that we reaching out on your behalf. God, you see the uplifted hands. Don't let a need be unmet. God, that great apostle spoke and said, my God shall supply your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Lord, let it be so. God, let it be so. Lord, let it be so, God. In the name of Jesus, God, work out every need for your glory and sanctify all these services. Lord Jesus, we behold you as the Almighty, as the fullness of the Godhead, bodily, the head of the church. You the vine, we the branches. You the tree, we the limbs. God, and help us. God, in the name of Jesus, Lord. Lord, in the name of Jesus, you see what's in my heart. Give me my heart's desire, Lord. God, let your will be done. Give me, and be it so, Lord. And every need out there, Lord, and every request, and everybody that's reaching out to you right now, let it be so in their lives. Oh, God, Father, in the name of Jesus, God, in the name of Jesus, we ask for it to be so. In the name of Jesus, God, we ask for it to be so. For your glory, God, in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. We decree an answer to all needs. And behold you as the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. And we thank you. Let everybody lift up your hand and give the Lord a praise. Thank God. all in Jesus' name. Father, for your glory. Thank you, Jesus. This won't be the title of the message, but this come to me this morning. In my name, they shall cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. Of course, you know we find in the scriptures that one writer of the scriptures said, generation of vipers, they shall take up serpents. If they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. None of that part I don't practice. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. And thank you, Lord. Mighty God, thank you, Jesus. Oh, I feel God. Thank the Lord. When I woke up this morning, I could hear the writer of the book of Acts speaking about Paul. God works special miracles. You'll find that in 19, 11, and 12 by the hands of Paul. So they brought these sick folks. And then John 14 said, the works that I do, that's 11 through 14, shall you do. And I don't know why those scriptures just hit me. And for this to just being a Christian don't make this happen. You know, just being saved. You know, a lot of time people, you can't make miracles. You know, Jesus, if you read over there in the gifts, later I want to get in the gifts, the Lord willing. The Lord dealt with me that while I was down in Mexico a few days ago. This whole revival and us ministers. And these signs shall follow them that believe. I don't mean all believers. But at some point or another, if you're a believer and walk the line, you'll be asked, if you pray in person, you live in your home and out there on the streets, what you live in church, somewhere or another, and pray and read your Bibles, these signs is going to happen to every believer. We may not all be, the Bible said we'd all have gifts of healing. And the Lord just come to me down in Mexico, said, my people are claiming these things. But God has to be the one. To one is given. It's good to be hungry for something to help folks with, but you just can't go out here. Sometimes it's like marriage. You know, people go out here and see, pick somebody out. Someone said, that'll make me a good husband to go. That don't always work. And that don't always, God don't always put that kind of people together. Just cause you got somebody to say a little hocus pocus over you and join your hand. That don't make a mess. What God puts together, you know. And that's where there's these gifts of the Holy Ghost. You can, you got a desire. You want to be used. But you got to find out what God, see, God knows what you can handle and what you can use and what you can't. You know. And it don't make one preacher better than another. It's God don't look at us like we look at one another. God said, you've not chosen me, but I've chosen you and ordained you for this and this. But so many people. And but anyway, while I was down in Mexico, just like I don't go hardly nowhere when I'm in a meeting, I stayed there in the place where they had me to stay. And searching the scriptures, no gun smoke or no nothing to watch, because everything was in Spanish, and I don't know. Well, I can say, si, senor, el senor le bendiga, or something like that, but I'm talking about somebody tell me that on what you're saying. Glory. And I'm searching for God. I've never been at ease in Zion. My whole life is something, as I search the scriptures, there's something missing and have been missing. I've been in the church, Pentecostal church kind of movement, since the latter part of 51 when I started going. They want me to come in and sing. I thought all churches were the same, you know. All my dad's folks, except them. Now, he was Pentecostal. He was holiness. But all his family was seven brothers, preachers. God is looking for vessels. It ain't what your folks was. It ain't what somebody you've been under. You got to search. See what God has called you to do. You can't be nobody else. You got to feel after him. The Bible said, when he's talking about the gifts, and he dealt me with them gifts, and I got back, I talked to Sister Terrell about it. How did she feel? I just felt like that we're sitting right ready. And I read and reread and searched, and you know, hearing the apostles reading their message, such as I have, I give you in the name of Jesus Christ, rise up to cripples or others and be made whole. These guys, they wasn't somebody just wanted to be a preacher. Peter was a good fisherman. And he got in a storm, and Jesus saw him out there, knew it. He knows all things, and he come walking on the water out there towards Peter's boat. And Peter saw him and recognized, said, if that's you, bid me to come. And Jesus said, come. So Peter got out of that ship and walked on that water going to Jesus. But somewhere, ever what the distance, he took his eyes off of Jesus. And the waters was wavy and heavy, and looked on the water, and it began to sink. But Jesus was close enough to him to reach and grabbed him. When he began to see the storm of the waves, he went into fear, and fear leads you into doubt. Leads you into doubt, whether you know or not. There's two kinds of fear. There's a fear of God, fear, you know, but God don't want you running around scared to death all the time. Not that kind of fear. Bible says if you fear him, you love him, you will keep his commandments. And Jesus reached and grabbed Peter, and they came both walking on back to the ship on the water. And Jesus looked at Peter and said, why did you doubt? See, you, otherwise, what I'm saying, we're living in an hour that you can't take your eyes off of Jesus. Peter said, Jesus, if that's you, bid me to come to you. That's what he's doing right now, is seeing us, bidding us. That's why the old saying is, clean up your own house or your own lives before you try to clean up somebody else's. See who you are. You know, we don't, there's one thing about it, God had never privileged me or you to look into people's hearts. He may let us see the needs in people's lives, but he don't let us see in people's hearts and know what people's minds. That's all our imaginations and judging. But anyway, while I was down there, the Lord spoke to me one morning. He said, I'm the vine and you the branches. I've always said that chapter 15 should be 14 and 14 should be 15. But, you know, man, they have done the chapter about this. You know, the God's word was all, and of course they done a good job at it. But it just don't, 15 don't make sense. You get over there trying to get to the works of Christ, you first got to realize that Jesus is the vine and you the branch. Before the Jesus told us here in 14 the works that he's doing, if we believe, the works shall we do, and more or greater works in him. Oh, actually, if you look that up in the original Greek that the King James has translated, said more. Otherwise, we got an opportunity. Sister Turner, we got an opportunity to reach the world. You know, God has tens of thousands of miles. About any way you want to go, there's people wanting the truth. People ain't like it is in America. Even what we call the heathens, they pray to their gods, but they're going to get them. But down inside, they keep looking for a real God. And all they know is images. It ain't just that they're going out there worshiping a cow or worshiping some kind of an image. It's that they are searching, because God puts it in people's hearts. We're not animals. God puts it in our hearts to know that there's something out there beyond the church. There's something out there beyond what we call Pentecost. There's something out there besides being saved. There's a deliverer. I said there's a deliverer. God said if we'd offer ourselves to walk as he walks and deny ourselves and take up our cross. I don't need you to help me take up my cross. That ain't going to help me at all. It's going to take the load off of me and make me lazy. I need to carry my own cross. And you need to carry your cross. Instead of always wanting somebody else to shoulder your load, carry your cross. You made for something. God didn't make you a bystander. But out of many that's called, because few of them out of that many is trying to humble themselves, trying to be molded, to be made. You know, I was last night reaching out and thinking, I started to get up and look at, but it's there in Jeremiah Well, the vessel was marred in the potter's hand. You know, they made pottery out of clay. Yes. And it was marred, and otherwise it didn't come out right. It wasn't made. But the pottery didn't throw the clay away. He didn't dump it in the trash can. He took it and he made it again. That's what we missed it. We're always trying to make somebody else. But we need to be made again. I said, myself. If I ever reach the top of the mountain, it's going to take a supernatural power to get down. Man, you get up there, you know. You have to get down. So, we don't need to fly so high till we can't come down. You know. And God is ready to do the works of Christ in you and I, but we ain't ready for Him to do the works of Christ in us. You know, there's a price to pay, so to speak. There's a cross to bear. That's the reason God told us, before you got into these works in 15, I am the vine, Jesus said. You the branch. You ain't the vine. You're not the tree. You the limbs. And sometimes for that tree to be what it's supposed to be, you gotta take one of them little saw. I used to do that kind of work. Just don't regular old saw, don't do it. You got to take a special axe and a special piece of equipment, because you got to get that. If you're going to cut them limbs off, you got to get it right as close to the tree. Then you take a little something you got and smear over that. And that was sort of like putting a bandage on a sore. Thank God. And that tree will never feel the effect of losing that limb that was dead weight to it. And then you see that those dead limbs or dead vines, when that, what we call sap, goes up that tree, then that old dead limb gets part of it and makes that tree not get what it wants. Otherwise, we are trees, as the Bible said, of righteousness. And we don't keep these dead limbs off of us, and that ain't worth being on us nohow. Let take them off of us and get rid of them, where that when that Holy Ghost sap comes up through there, it won't run out in that old dead limb. It didn't do nothing but hinder God. It'll go on up to them good limbs that you've got, those limbs that's going to have them peaches and them big old beautiful apples, a whole grapevines, got them big. I worked in all that growing up, and we had to keep them dead limb, but you had to do it when the sap's down. You know what I'm talking about? You couldn't do it when the sap's up. You got to do it somewhere long in the wintertime, and when little flowers begin to blow, the sap's coming up. When them little flowers begin to pop out on different things, the sap's coming up. You don't see them little limbs that we've got having them little blossoms anymore. You know why? You don't see it anymore. You don't see them little blossoms, because we've got so much weight down here, so much of self down here. By the time that Holy Ghost is coming up in us, it's done sapped all the victory we got. And time we get up out of those limbs of ours that needs, and our mind, these hands that needs power in them to lay hands on the sick, these ears to hear what the Holy Ghost is speaking to the church, that we can hear what God is speaking to the church, that these eyes can behold the Lamb of God, that all power in heaven and earth is in Him. And all of this year that we do to weaken our eyes, to weaken our strength, but from coming up here, see, the Jesus comes up. When the sap comes up, the tree. He said, you're trees. He don't start to sap up down at the top. You're trees of righteousness, he said. You're like trees. He don't start up yonder blessing you up yonder. That's what everybody wants. They want God to make them a big old tree and put all these gifts in them when they're up here and they don't even know what they got. God starts down here at the root. Amen. That's reading the Bible said, be rooted and grounded in God, in the Word, in Jesus Christ. And if the Spirit has its way, no doubt later, you'll be at the place. I hope I am. Bible said, desire. Don't want spiritual gift because you've seen somebody else. How God marvelously used them. Bible said, examine yourself. See where you at. See if you be in faith. See if you're hunger. You know, we're not out here to get attention. We're not out here to draw people to us. We're out here as a conduit flowing. We're out here, these lights, them lights are bright, that light. It's that line, that electricity. See, that's God coming up right. Y'all think y'all that light. Y'all ain't that light. It's them wires. It's hooked out yonder that meter. Do you see what I'm telling you? And it's out there hooked to that, where that electricity, where they got that meter and the power people, and God is the power people. He done hooked up your meter. Thank God he done hooked you up. Praise God. I said, he done hooked you up. Praise God to that main line. You ain't got somebody went plugged in the wall out there and got one of these wires that ain't hooked up. Jesus wants to connect me and you to the main line. He wants to connect us to them big old poles out yonder that's like furnishing electricity for this whole city. He wants us to be connected to one of them big old what to call them things up there, shooting that electricity through there. Hallelujah. And all them wires. Thank God he wants to connect us up to that main line. He don't want us to be a little red wire around here hooked up to something else, getting your help from somewhere else. God wants you to get your connection up under to God. He don't want you to be some line connected. He wants to for you to connect to him. Hallelujah. Feel the Holy Ghost. I said he wants you to get your meter hooked up to the main pole, to the main line. This power ain't coming out of Memphis. It's coming out of heaven. This anointing of Jesus Christ that God is pouring out, this fresh anointing across the face of the earth, where he can find people to connect themselves to God. And when it's all done, they know they are not the light. They the bub, but they not the light. God. Yes. Through God you can do all things. Through God. That's the reason I believe in it. Was translating the Bible from the Greek over to us, the King James way. I like it better. Somewhere 400 or 500 years ago, when all this is happening, they put 15, which should have been 14, because it tells about the vine. See, how are you gonna get over here and do the works of Christ when you don't even know where you're getting it? You know, some people don't agree with me, but I know that those theologians, they was good, and I appreciate them. But they should have put that 14, 15, and that 14, 15, and that 15. It's a vine, see? And that 14 to do them works of God that Jesus said has got to be connected to that vine. You don't connect the vine to the miracle. You don't connect the vine to the gifts of healing. Thank God. Hallelujah. You got to get the gifts of healing from the vine. Jesus said, I'm the vine. And what are you? You the branch. I'm the vine and you the branch. And every branch in me that bears not fruit is taken away. Never brings it by fruit. He purchases it. And I believe with all my heart that we're fixing a step the real sold out, self-denied. I believe we're fixing a, the Lord came to me once in the early days and said, before he comes, there's going to be a Jesus revival. The real works of Christ. It's going to be like a, well, the Bible said, out of our bellies shall flow rivers of living waters. Thank God. But it's going to take, you know, these holy men taught us to lay aside all our weights and our little no harm sins. Even told us to put a bridle on our tongues. So you put bits in a horse's mouth to guide it. Like putting a bridle on it. You don't ride a horse with a halter. You got to have something, a bridle that goes in his mouth. If he does get a little out of hand, that you can control it. Some people down here trying to have all these gifts with a halter. God wants something to put bits in a horse's mouth to control the horse. See, we like animals. We like horses. We like what they use. You know, back then they even had those bulls. But they had to put them halters. You can't handle one. And God can't handle us if he first can't put the bits in our mouth to control our mouths. See? We're always looking at somebody else. But God said, examine yourselves. See if you. And so that's the reason John is writing to us about Jesus is telling John, speaking, John being a half brother to him, because Jesus was a direct son of God. And John was writing about God unveiled to him that Jesus said, I'm the vine and you the branch, and every branch in me. So that's where we come in now. We just branches. And my soul is searching God to disconnect me from all my dead works. You know, the Bible speaks about people's works being dead. No life in them. God wants us to be renewed in the Holy Ghost. You know, somebody gets received the Holy Ghost and they get satisfied. But God wants us to be renewed in the Holy Ghost. And so he's telling us that I'm the vine, you the branch. Every branch in me that bears not fruit, he takes it away. Every branch that bears fruit, he purges it, that bring forth more. Otherwise, God don't throw you out the door because you got a bad branch on you. He just wants you to Let him cut that off. And put a little bit of that, what the brush puts on there to cover that place up. Thank God, pretty soon you'll grow over that, and you'll never know. You know, people that loses a hand sometimes, or lose a leg, they get to where they can get about just like anybody else. Well, sometimes we have to lose some of ourselves to take on Jesus Christ. And he is ready. And all that whole time down in Mexico, the Lord was dealing with me. He said, the time has come that the gifts of the Holy Ghost is going to be restored back into the body of Christ. And every man and woman, especially ministers, it's if you're going to do something for God, Bible said he led captives and give gifts, led people out of captive, got them out of it, give gifts to men. Thank God he got us out of these traps and he put us out there where he can give. God, I know that God is ready to, the Bible said he set them in the church, but the church ain't the building. The church is the believers. Yeah. And he's, but it don't mean that everybody's going to get a gift. Right. You know, somebody got to be dishwashers. Somebody's got to be the cook. Somebody's got to be the one that cleans up. You know, but yet when it's all put together, the house is in order. But see, everybody wants to do what they want to do. And that's the reason you'll find one of God's servants, that God made him a great servant of God. He came to God wanting to be used of God. He told God, I'll be a doorkeeper in the house of God. And I'll stand there when people, you know, you got people in businesses that stand there. People come in, they open the door. Let them in, hotels and so forth. The guy back behind the counter can't always run. They got, well, that's what God needs is some doorkeepers. But nobody wants to be a doorkeeper. Back when I first come into Holiness, you know, Holiness folks were so dedicated to God. Women used to sit on one side and the men on the other. And they'd have a woman back at the door when people coming in, and a man come in. You've been in some of the places that they walk a man down there, find a seat. They don't let them just sit in the back. They want them up front first, and then the woman's. Well, that's what we are. The Bible said we're doorkeepers in the house of God. Thank God we're trying, when these sinners comes in and these sick people come in, we're trying to be there. Praise God, to make sure that we can take that person down there where they can hear that word, where they can get ministered to, instead of sitting there wondering and everything. The house of God is not in order in these days. When I first come into the church, they used to walk at a church. That's when I first began to know her, and I thought, this who this is, man. She makes my heart get in my mouth. But anyway, and she'd walk them sisters down everywhere they sat. Thank God. I was wanting her to walk me. Hallelujah. But anyway, but she wasn't walking me in glory. But you know, she grew up, and you know, that put something in her. She grew that in church. Come up in another kind of faith, but grew up, thank God, to know God. Hallelujah. You know, a lot of us, we don't want to grow. We want to just go in here and what we want, just fight our way through, slang people out of the way, and get in there ourselves. But that's got the church off balance. brought jealousy, it's brought envy, it's brought strife, it's brought, and we're not out here to show that we're pretty than anybody else. Amen. Sometimes ugly it looks better than pretty. You know, because they don't run around here trying to show off the pretty. You know, they just look the best they can and have a good conduct. And that spirit that's in them makes them more beautiful sometimes than the movie star. Well, I say I ain't getting much, but God is telling us, I'm the vine and you the branch. And we're fixing, you can mark what I'm telling you. He said, you the branch, and he's fixing to start these miracles. Spoke to me, I had a vision down yonder in Mexico that I saw had come right here in this minister's meeting somewhere, that God is ready, if we can get ready, to give us the gifts. I talked to Sister Tola either down there when I got back. I said, I feel like God is want me, but I want you to pray with me. That you know, I've talked about the gifts a lot, but I went through those gifts of the Holy Ghost. To one is given, to another is given. And it ain't something you choose. It's something that you may thirst and search the scriptures and say, God, I like this, I like that. But you got to find out. See, God knows what's best for you, and he can give you these gifts of spirit. I know they're dormant. They people run around here claiming how this and that, and this gift of prophecy, and this and that, and 98% of what they prophesy, nothing ever comes of it. Thank God when you get that real gift that God lets you speak that word, a real gift of prophecy is coming direct out of the Holy Ghost, speaking just like God, instead of God standing there speaking, he's speaking to a human being, hallelujah, what he wants said, and that word that's coming out of that person is sanctified and dedicated, and don't think, boy, I've got something nobody else has got, because we all getting light from not that bub out there, but we're getting it from the people that put up these big old poles around here, and people put up these here big old things that transfer that light through here. Thank God we just ain't nothing but a pole. We ain't nothing but a line. And that light that's coming in here is coming direct from heaven. Praise God. Jesus said, I'm the light of the world. I'm the true vine. I'm the vine. And you ain't nothing but a branch. And if you're in me and you keep yourself purged, he said, then ever what I am, you are. As he is in this world, so are you. You begin to bring forth peaches. You begin to bring forth grapes. You may not have that cluster. You may not have that big old apple, but you're going to have what you are and what that vine, that branch is. You're going to be that, and it's going to be good to eat. It's going to be good, hallelujah, that people's going to want to buy you if you sacked up in a little sack in a good grocery store. They're going to want you to minister to them. We are just little branches. We're just little grapes on the vine. We're not the vine. He said, I'm the vine, you the branch. Thank God, I'm the apple tree, but I'm the trunk, but you the limbs. And we need to get these limbs straightened out with God. We need to quit looking and judging everybody else and think we're a better limb than them. Ain't nobody better than nobody. We all just a bunch of dirt out there that God put together and made man and woman out of it. Thank God it's time for us to realize that our Lord wants to pour rivers, not creeks, not little water faucets, but rivers, rivers, rivers of living waters coming out of us. Thank you, Jesus. We're sitting right at the hour that I saw. God said in the church, in the body, not the building, not just the tent, but God sent in the church these 9 spiritual gifts that makes up the total man, Jesus Christ. Thank God. I don't care if it is nothing. You know, there's a difference in the language that they spoke on the day of Pentecost than the gift. And one of the gifts, the Bible called it unknown tongue. And nobody understands it but somebody that gets interpretation. They're speaking in a regular tongue, because on the day of Pentecost there was 50 different countries there when the Holy Ghost fell, and everybody all in 50 countries. That was the last day of that 50 days that they met every 50 years. These 50 countries met there and had that big thing there in Jerusalem. And on that 50th day, God chose it to pour out the Holy Ghost. And all them people, businessmen and all these big shots, heard all these nobodies speaking in languages. And they began to, an old language was the language over here in America. Somebody was speaking in English. Somebody was speaking in German. Somebody was speaking in Russian. And that they didn't know what to do. And thousands of people. Hallelujah. Because everybody from there was 50 countries that met every 50 years heard somebody speaking in their language and where they was born. And some of them didn't know what it was. Others said, this is a gift of God. Peter stood up. Hallelujah. Said, these ain't drunk as you suppose, but this is that God has spoken by Joel and the prophet that he is now. Jesus has gone back to heaven 10 days ago. He's at the right hand of the Father, and he told us when he got back, he's going to send us the Comforter. This is the Holy Ghost that Jesus has sent back. Praise God from heaven. Didn't he say he'd send us back the Comforter? Well, he sent it back on the day of Pentecost, and it came for in 50 different languages, 50 different countries, languages, and everybody heard some, that 120 heard somebody speaking in their language. Some said, what is this? Others said, this has got to be God. Hallelujah. This has got to be God. This is the wonderful works of God. Those 50 people, ever how many came from those different 50 countries, over 50,000 people were there on that day. Everybody carried this message that happened on the day of Pentecost back to their country, back to their land, and said, we just was in something over yonder. This didn't just start 100 years ago. This didn't start 400 years ago. This didn't start. This started on the day of Pentecost, which they celebrated every 50 years. You never hear no more of those countries gathering anymore after that. They've done it every 50, but they never done it no more. Hallelujah. They didn't need to. Thank God had everybody there from every country in the world hearing somebody speak in their tongue and preaching Jesus, giving a testimony of the Holy Ghost. That's what the tongues are. It's to edify God. It's to not to edify you, but it's to edify Jesus Christ. It's to lift up Jesus Christ. It's to exalt Jesus Christ. It's to get your eyes up on, behold, the Lamb of God that takes away. If we get here, you're going to see the works. You're going to see he's the vine, you that little old branch. And as long as you'll stay that way, thank God. Some of you may never get your husband or your wife in. Some of you may never see your children. What I'm saying, you may have to go on alone before it's over. And that's what you need to put all your attention. You be a good husband, be a good wife. But don't try to make her what you are, and don't try to make him what you are. Be what God wants you to be, and then God can blend. See, this is a God thing. This ain't a man thing. This ain't just a message I put together. The vine up yonder that he's connected us to is sending that Holy Ghost. He's sending it up from the roots. He's keeping them roots alive. And once more, a good tree is going to bring forth Jesus kind of fruit. Fruit of the Spirit. You know, there's 9 gifts of the Holy Ghost. But if you search it out, there's 9 fruits of the Spirit. Thank God, too. And that's what I need. And that's what we all need. Thank God. And that's the reason God said, pray earnestly for the best gift. Not what you think's best, but what God can do for you. And what you can use. There's a world out there. We know America right now is on the downturn. But that's happened. Christianity fell across Europe down to 2%. All them countries. I preached in all of them in the early days. But now God is taking the gospel. And the Bible said he's taking it to who? Giving it to the heathens. Yes. That's what he's doing. Where the real Bible is the heathens. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Let's just sink down. We can't, you know. I know that there's no doubt in my mind that we can open up our heart and quit looking at others, quit judging one another for these next 8 days is out. That God, I believe with all of my heart, God, man can't tell me what to do. I've been reaching out as deep as I ever have for God to let me know. Because if we ever need the gifts of the Holy Ghost, we need them now. But we just can't see what we think is best. Let God tell us what's best for us. Look at the man in the Bible that became greatest. You know who he was? The doorkeeper. Look it up. Follow his life. Go back to history on it. Thank God. You know why he was willing to open the door? When I met Sister Terrell, she stood back there and opened that door for the women, and somebody else over there opened that door. A doorkeeper. That's what she was. A doorkeeper. Thank God. In Brother Ford's church. Thank you, Jesus. And to be part of that, to be privileged. That's where I first saw her. I think, well, she came to a couple of meetings in Atlanta. And my heart felt something, but I brushed it off. But when I saw her, I came in the back door because they would let me come through the back when I went in that new church. But I'd stand back there and I'd watch. My heart was seeing how, thank you, Jesus. Glory. And a voice spoke to me, said, there is someone that'll stand with you. Not just to be, to get your name, but to stand with you, to help you, to be there. Thank God. That's what God wants. He not want to change your name. He wants you, praise God, to be what He wants. Thank God that there's a revival that's going to be birthed somewhere. I want America. I don't know about you. I've reached over 200 countries and 90% of my support, at least 85, have been Americans. They sent me. There's been time I couldn't have gone. There's been time I left. I didn't have for years. There was a company that bought my tickets, and that's all I had. But I didn't worry. God always somehow made a way, and I didn't touch. When these offerings are counted, I check it, make sure it's counted and sealed up. Thank you, Jesus. God more than takes care of me. Thank the Lord. I was telling some other day I was in Bombay and didn't have a dime. Just got there, but a man across the over saw me and hollered at me. And I run over there, and he gave me $70,000. Thank you, Jesus. And that helped me to pay all the meetings and take care of it. Scared me. I just want you to know God. I don't care where you at. He's there. If you get in His place, you get in His mind, you get in His position, you let Him mold you. You let Him make you. Quit trying to boss your home, or quit trying to run around here, be chief sheep shepherd. Be what God wants you to be. Humble yourself. Get, instead of getting at the top of the cross, get down at the foot of the cross, the old timers used to say. Humble yourself before the throne of grace, that you may find mercy and find what you need in time of your need. And you'll find out that He is the vine and you the branch. You'll find out the works that He did. These signs will follow them that believe. You may not be an evangelist. You may not be a pastor, an overseer. I just refuse to be an overseer. I'm just who I am. God is right now preparing a people, a great number that no man can number. And this is to happen not 2,000 years ago, because the moon has never turned to blood yet. The Bible said the moon would turn to blood and the sun would turn into darkness. And at that time, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh. Thank God. And that's what we need to be reaching out for. Lord, help me to be a vessel that's not marred. It's been remade. We all have been marred, but Jesus said, if you get back in my hand, I'll remold you. And I'll remake you. I'll remake you. He made it again, a vessel. Don't you want to walk in that place? Thank you, Jesus. If you feel... I know God's got these gifts of the Holy Ghost, but you need to be searching your heart, see where you at, see if you can't find what God could connect you to. Let's come around this front here and offer ourselves.
Spirit, and I will pour out rivers of living waters, shall flow out of your bellies, flowing out for those that are thirst and hunger for God. Let not your heart be troubled, let it not be afraid. Look not upon others, but behold the Lamb of God that called you, that chosen you, that got you out of sin into where you are today. To put the hunger in your heart, the thirst after righteousness and true holiness from your heart and soul, and you will behold the fullness of the stature of the body of Christ. And the works that you do will not be you, but I, the Lord, working through you. Hallelujah. Let's pray. Let's all pray.